took my picture and said she's going to send it to her friend in Washington, D.C. to say, see, there are black people in California that will walk. There have been sidewalk counselors on the sidewalk in Oakland for more than a decade. I'm Jack Sullivan. He said, it is my turn. About 12, 13 years ago. I got letters on my bracelet to serve as my ID. I got the necklace and the keychain and almost everything a good Christian needs. Yeah. But everybody that was on the sidewalk before Walter was either Caucasian, there was even an Asian lady. But when the African American man stepped on the sidewalk, now we need to call the police. Before you walk across my floor, I got a Jesus bumper sticker and the outline of a fish stuck on my car. Cover it up.
Oh, so you can't wear anything like that?
I don't know. It's since I'm new at this.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right. Excellent, excellent. This is Lori Hoye, wife and co-founder of Issues4Life.org, correct? Is it org?
Yes,
org. And Pastor Hoye is serving 30 days in Santa Rita Jail here in Dublin, California, for nothing more than standing outside an abortion facility in Oakland on May 13th,
right.
2008. Lori, could you tell us how Walter is doing?
Well, Walter is, he's doing well considering, but he's not getting much sleep. He said that he ran this down his schedule on Sunday. He said they actually have church at midnight. And last Sunday, there's a gentleman that can actually sing, but he didn't know Amazing Grace. So they taught him Amazing Grace. So they had like a full-blown worship service last Sunday. He said that he actually preached a sermon because the men inside are, with the situation that happened in Oakland with the police officers, right? And most of the guys are drug dealers, and you know, he said they call them the 5-0. You know, they were actually, you know, happy about, you know, what happened to the officers, which is not good. And he said he preached a sermon and he talked about, you know, when Jesus was arrested and Peter whacked off the ear of the, you know, the guard, and you know, Jesus put the man's ear back on, and he said Jesus went peaceably with the authorities. He said it wasn't, you know, Jesus didn't attack the authorities, and that's not, you know, we shouldn't be doing that. So he's been working with them. I mean, even when it first happened, I know last Saturday he said that they were kind of locked down because, you know, I guess when something happens out here, it impacts them in there. He said, so he noticed that their free time was cut off and a lot of things. And he said that even then he was telling them that this was a tragedy. This is not something good. And we should be praying for the officers and their families because this is, you know, a terrible thing that happened. But, you know, it's a different mindset on the other side of that wall. And so he's, you know, he's still holding his ground.
He's getting an opportunity to be salt and light in the darkness.
In the darkness. And he has... he's led a total of 5 men to Christ. I said, he's only
praise
been
God.
There 8 days. So,
it's like, and a long God. Way to go.
Go, God.
Yeah.
You know, oh, yeah. So that is wonderful. But, you know, his spirits are up, and he knows that there are a lot of people praying for him. He said that his mail is even a witness. He said he got a stack of mail like this high. And, of course, the guards who are bringing you this much mail and the inmates who are seeing you get this much mail want to know, why are you getting this much mail? You know, who is this guy? You know, what's going on? And so he said that that has also been a witness. So he wanted to encourage everybody to keep the cards, letters, you know, whatever, you know, just keep writing, keep sending stuff in, because he's actually using that to witness to the inmates and to the guards.
Well, Lori, can you tell me a little about the history? I'm new to your struggle in the last about 15, 20 days, something like that. And I'd like to know where this all began. Where did Issues4Life start, and when did God lay this issue of abortion on yours and your husband's hearts?
Okay. Well, I was going to say, Walter and I have different histories with abortion, but it kind of, for the both of us, I would say 2005, our church actually had a conference called Issues That Matter. And Walter got Star Parker, who's an excellent speaker. If you don't know Star Parker, her organization is CURE, Coalition for Urban Renewal and Education. She was a former welfare mom. She was, you know, she's had a few abortions, and she came to Christ, and her life has just, you know, turned around totally. So she shared her testimony, and she actually came and talked to our church about abortion. She came and talked to us about, I mean, government legislation. She talked to people about welfare and getting off of what she calls Uncle Sam's Plantation, and she actually wrote a book by that title, Uncle Sam's Plantation. And so Star Parker came and shared with our church Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and then Dr. Clinard Childress, who everybody knows is blackgenocide.org, and he was also at the sentencing on the 20th on Friday. So the two of them came to our church and spent basically a weekend with our church talking about abortion, talking about homosexuality, talking about welfare, Social Security. And it kind of, you know, got our church thinking about, you know, hey, these issues need to be looked at a different way. Well, in the process of meeting them in August, the two of them told us they were coming back in January. We'll be back here in San Francisco for the Walk for Life West Coast, right, which we hadn't heard of. So we said, fine. So we hooked up with them in January of 2006 at the Walk for Life West Coast, where, I mean, to my dismay, I had a lot of people take my picture, and it was kind of, you know, bizarre initially. You know, people were like, oh, can I take your picture? Can I take your picture? And it was like, okay. I mean, I'm just here with my church, and, you know, we had a banner. I mean, it wasn't anything spectacular. But what it was that we were the first, this was the second walk, but we were the first African-American people to walk with them. I mean, Star Parker, Dr. Childress speaks every time, but outside of having somebody African-American as a speaker, they had never had anybody come just from, you know, the community in general to walk with them at the Walk for Life. And I even had one lady took my picture and said she's going to send it to her friend in Washington, D.C. to say, see, there are black people in California that will walk for life. So that kind of started the journey to, I mean, for me, it was kind of like, I'm disturbed that you need to take my picture because I'm such a novelty. And that's something, considering the death rate in the African-American community because of abortion, that we should be everywhere.
January 2006.
And we were actually on the platform behind Dr. Childress. Our church had a banner, and since we had just met him in August, and so he pulled us up on the stage. And because they want that African-American presence. And Star Parker had her arm around us and the whole bit. And I guess Mary Arnold and Jenny Hitchcock, who are two ladies who were sidewalk counseling already in Oakland, sent an email to Dr. Childress to say, hey, do you know any African-Americans who would be willing to come out onto the sidewalk? Because we're at a clinic in Oakland where the women are predominantly African-American, and we're really not able to have an impact on them. So Clinard sent the email to Walter, and Walter said, okay, don't know what sidewalk counseling is, but Freddie D'Alessio came to our church, and they trained people and had a couple of sessions, and actually got out on the sidewalk. And when he initially got out there, he said he noticed that they started to call the police, you know, so that the police would come up. But backing up, though, there have been sidewalk counselors on the sidewalk in Oakland for more than a decade. I talked to another gentleman named Jack Sullivan, who said he and his wife have been out there about 12, 13 years ago. There have been, but there was another lady that was with, I mean, Freddie was here, Jenny and Mary, but everybody that was on the sidewalk before Walter was either Caucasian, there was even an Asian lady. But when the African-American man stepped on the sidewalk, now we need to call the police. And the police even came, Walter said, they came and they actually coached him on how to stand on the public sidewalk and when people drive up, how much space you need to give them so they can get out of the car so you can still get your message across to them without encroaching on people's personal space. And one of the police officers, he said, told him, he said, now, you know you're at the hornet's nest, and so you got to expect when you disturb the hornets that sometimes you're going to get stung. So you need to just be aware of these are the things that you need to do and go from there. So the police didn't work because he was on a public sidewalk, and so then they employed escorts, these people with the Caltrans vests, and these people are pushy, these people are rude, these people are obnoxious, but still, they could not shake Walter. I mean, in fact, these people were getting reprimanded for talking to Walter. One lady even coached Walter, one of the